all going to get them on Monday.
All right, I'd like to welcome everyone to tonight's meeting. The board just met in executive session to consider matters regarding proposed, pending, or current litigation, matters leading to the appointment or employment of a particular person or persons, and collective negotiations pursuant to Article 14 of the Civil Service Law, the Taylor Law. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. So welcome to tonight's meeting. We do have some special student recognition tonight that we're very anxious to attend to. But first, I wanted to share some other important news that developed just 24 hours ago. On Tuesday morning, I received a letter that I would like to share with you. Dear President McCary, please be advised that I am resigning from the Board of Education for North Shore Central School District, effective immediately, due to pressing personal matters that require my attention. Hopefully, this notice affords the district sufficient time to include the seat for the remainder of my term in the upcoming election for the Board of Trustees to be held on May 21st. It is my intent that by resigning at this time, that my replacement will be democratically elected without the necessity of the district incurring the cost of a special election. It has been my honor and privilege to serve as a trustee for nearly 11 years. Of course, if I can assist the district in any manner in the future, please do not hesitate to contact me. Very truly yours, Marianne M. Russo. So that is why you don't see Marianne appear at the dais tonight with us. The law doesn't allow for it since her resignation was effective immediately. But at North Shore, we don't allow people to resign without a proper goodbye. And luckily, unfortunately, Marianne is here today in the audience. Marianne, say hi. So we're going to give Marianne a chance to speak, but not yet. First, I want to give all the trustees an opportunity to say something. Remember, we only have 48 hours. This is big news. Rich, I was hoping you could start first.
Sure. Thank you. And please bear with me. I
don't read real well, but I'll do my best. Marianne Russo has been a very positive, active force in advocating for the students of the North Shore schools and for this community. Through her tireless efforts, she has devoted countless hours of volunteer service to our community in a variety of roles and undertakings. She has been and is an outstanding leader and a pillar of our community. Marianne is a very busy and successful attorney in private practice, but has managed to unselfishly give immeasurable hours in service to all of us. From the time her children were young, she became a very active person in the North Shore schools. She was a leader in the PTO at the Glen Head Elementary School, taking on many supportive and leadership positions for several years. Her participation and leadership in these groups proved to be a very beneficial and useful tool for the students at the school and the community at large. Marianne consistently worked to help others, and when a job needed to be done, she was the first to volunteer. As her children got older, she continued this outstanding and beneficial work in the parent-teacher student organizations of the North Shore Middle School and the North Shore High School. In May 2013, Marianne was elected to a seat as a trustee on the Board of Education of the North Shore Central Schools and has been a very dynamic trustee for the past nearly 11 years. Her work on the board is without parallel. Her razor-sharp intellect and keen insight has served the community in innumerable ways, as she always advocated for our students and for the betterment of our schools and community. Her legal background and expertise helped guide the board in a way that none of the other trustees could or can do. Many of the issues unique to the district are areas in which Marianne brought great knowledge and clarity to the table, and her efforts to help our community are Herculean. During her time as a trustee, she has been directly involved in the hiring of two district superintendents, along with quite a few administrative hirings. She has headed up the search for legal counsel for the district and has been a leader on the district's construction steering committee for her entire tenure on the board. She has been a board liaison for the Legislative Action Committee and a member of the Athletic Advisory Committee. Marianne has also reviewed the district's legal bills monthly. She had no personal agendas when it came to her work as a trustee and was always open to her constituents in the community, bringing their issues forth, always supporting those whom she represented. Although her own children had graduated from North Shore High School, she continued to fight for all the children of the community throughout her dedicated service as a trustee. She was and is an inspiration to all, and in recognition of her efforts to help the community, was named as a woman of distinction by the New York State Assembly during her tenure in office. Marianne Russo is truly phenomenal. She is a dynamo and has never ceased to put her heart and soul into volunteering for the betterment of our schools and community. It is my sincere hope that she will continue to be a force in this community. She will certainly be missed as a trustee of this board, and I cannot adequately thank her enough for all that she has done. I wish her all the best as she moves to her next chapter in her life.
Thank you, Rich. Trustee Cashman?
That's the one to follow then. Trustee Russo, or former Trustee Russo, I have had the least opportunity to work directly with you, but I can certainly speak to the commitment that you have made to this community and the razor sharp wit. Was that what I can't razor sharp intellect? Absolutely. It's been a pleasure to learn from you on construction and steering, of which you will be leaving a huge hole. These are, you know, serving this community for but over a decade is, these are schools that you built and the decisions that you made and the amount of children's whose lives that you've touched is really so remarkable. They're huge footsteps. You know, it's no secret that we haven't always agreed on this dais, but I personally see that as such a huge benefit to the community. It's not great when everybody agrees, and it's so vital that we have an active discourse, and I've appreciated everything that you've brought to the table, and you'll be missed. So thank you.
Vice President. Vice President Colasiopa.
Well, I echo my trustees' comments. It's hard to follow both of them. But I just want to add that I've learned so much from Mary Ann. Her legal expertise and her historic knowledge of the district has just been so very helpful to me during my 3 years here as a trustee. And one of the things that I value so much about this board is that we don't always agree. We have different opinions and perspectives, and we're not afraid to share them. No one here is a rubber stamp, and Mary Ann was never shy about voicing her opinion. I know Mary Ann began volunteering to help this district 23 years ago when her daughter entered kindergarten, and she hasn't stopped since. From fundraisers to PTOs and parent organizations to fashion shows to board committees to serving 11 years as a trustee. It isn't possible to count the number of hours that she devoted to this district. I know that as a trustee, Mary Ann always voted to adopt the budget and will continue to help our district thrive. I'm sure we'll see her at future board meetings, and I know that if I need any advice, I can reach out to Mary Ann, and she'll help in any way she can. Thank you so much, Mary Ann, for your service to our district and to the community and to our children.
Trustee Mosca.
Okay, well, I just want to point out I'm the one with the empty seat next to me now, but I think we're doing a good job of tag teaming tonight. I absolutely will echo what everyone has said before me, Mary Ann, and I'm so sorry that we missed voicemails this morning, but thank you for yours back to me. We will definitely have a follow-up in the next few days, I hope. I want to just add a small story, which is that in addition to all of the accomplishments that have already been cited about you, I want to add that you were one of the very early influencers for me to try to join the board. I met you when we were both volunteering for the committee to put forth the 2019 bond. And I remember walking out of one of those meetings, having been to some of these board meetings, you know, for the prior year, and been very impressed with all of the incredible work that the board was doing, and saying to you, you know, how do you do this? How do you balance this? You know, and thank you so much for your years of service. Then I was saying it since you started before I even moved to this town, and you know, you just made it sound like, of course, this is what you're going to do, and gave me sort of a great insight into what the role could be like and the rewards that could come from it. So I add that to the list of things for which I'm grateful to have known you. as a fellow Yankee fan, I do hope that relationship continues, and very much hope that you won't be a stranger. I look forward to getting acquainted with you as a civilian. So you know where to find us, and thank you from the bottom of my heart as well.
Trustee Ludmar is not here tonight, but I did ask him to send some comments, and these are his. While I've known for months that I would not be able to attend this meeting, I never imagined it would be held with an empty seat. I asked President McCary to read these words because I could not miss the opportunity to thank Marianne Russo publicly for her many years of service to this community, which began well before her years as trustee. She has been an intelligent, passionate advocate for the children and residents of North Shore. We've spent almost 8 years volunteering together on this board. That's hundreds of hours working side by side on this dais, in executive sessions, and on committees and employee search interviews, during which we were in agreement far, far more often than not. And even when we differed, our ultimate goal was always the same, to do what's best for the community. Her perspective and legal experience were most valued in grappling with two of the biggest challenges ever faced by our district: keeping our students safe and learning during the pandemic, and managing the ongoing impact of losing LIPA revenue. I will gladly confess that in those moments, this board had to make tough decisions in which there was no easy answer. I looked to Marianne for her guidance, logic, and support. Serving as a trustee takes time, sacrifice, and a thick skin. Everyone up here and everyone who came before us knows it is not easy. Marianne put herself in this crucible because she wanted to give back to her community, and she more than proved the depth of that commitment. That is a noble calling. I thank her for answering it and for all she has contributed. So Marianne, you are fierce. That's really what I have to say. And I think that you have made all of us up here and everyone who's come before, both administrators and trustees, even better. I was laughing today, actually thinking about my first board meeting as a trustee. I was so nervous, so enthusiastic, but so very, very naive with how it all worked. And I made a critical rookie mistake. When you were speaking, I interrupted you. And boy, did you let me know in your very Marianne way that that was just not going to fly. And not only am I pretty sure I never interrupted you again, but I learned not to interrupt my other trustees. But more importantly, I knew in that moment that it was serious business sitting up here. So thank you, not only for your 11 years of service, but for helping to set the expectations of this board and community high. I do also want to thank your family, your husband Michael, your son Mikey, and your daughter Katie. All of us know up here the amount of work a trustee puts in means they're not at home doing that work there. So thank you to your husband for sharing you with us for so many years. On behalf of the board, we wish you warm wishes in your next endeavor, and we know that you will remain a friend of the district. We do have parting gifts for you. I'd like to share them with you, and also invite you to the podium so that you can say some words. I will tell you the gifts. We have flowers for you. We have a famous North Shore pen, which you might have heard about. But we also, we wanted to give this to you.
Thank you, everyone. Those kind words. You have to excuse me, it's very emotional for me. It really has truly been an honor and a privilege to serve this community. It's an amazing place to live, to work, to learn, and to grow. And hopefully I'm leaving it a better place than how I found it. There are many parents in this audience, and I'm going to give a quick pitch for volunteerism. I know we're all busy, but I will tell you, you will get so much more out of being a volunteer than you give. You will have a bird's eye view into the amazing work that is done in our schools day in and day out. You will make your friends for life. I have my gang here. You'll make connections to people you would not have otherwise made, and you will set an example for your children. And in a blink of an eye, they will be grown up, and they will be volunteering in their own communities. I know this to be true because I watch my own kids do it. There's no better example about giving back than you doing it yourself and seeing it at home. I need to give out a few big thank yous. First, thank you to President Macari for giving me this opportunity to say goodbye. Thank you to my fellow trustees for your kind, kind words. I will cherish them. Thank you to the administration. I think you're administration number 4, Chris. I'm beginning to think it's me. I think we've done some really good work together. And thank you to the community who has supported me these past 11 years. You've not only said thank you the past couple of days, but over the 11 years, which really is what makes it all worthwhile. So I thank you for your support, for trusting your kids to me, your schools, your community. It's really been an honor. I do have to thank my friends who have been part of this crazy journey. Some of you from the early days at the PTO where we cooked up I don't know how many schemes, and some of you who I've met along the way. It's been a wild ride. I couldn't have done it without all of your help and support throughout the years, and I do think that the work we did as part of the parent organizations really changed the daily lives of the children in the schools. Thank you to our district clerk who has sworn me in here in this very room nearly 11 years ago. We share a birthday, and she always, always so helpful. Thank you to past boards, my mentor, Herman Berliner, my good friend, Rich Galati, who has taught me so much about education, volunteerism, and just being a good person. And last, but certainly not least, my family. To my children, Katie and Michael, who I've embarrassed on so many occasions, but have held their heads high. To my husband, Michael, who has not once complained about the hours, the commitment, the committees, and has answered every construction steering question I've had. I've already filled out his application for next year. He doesn't know it yet, but he does know it now. Welcome to Zoom. He'll be better than me at it. And I'm going to conclude on the note that I started with. This district is facing some huge financial obstacles. There are tough decisions ahead to be made. I'm sure we'll make the right decisions. You'll make the right decisions. Going forward, you know, that will benefit our children, keep our education safe, and allow our seniors to stay in this community because they are an integral part of this community. They are our volunteers, our supporters. They built these schools. They are part of the fabric, and we don't want them leaving. They're an absolute treasure, and we can't afford to lose them. So thank you all so very, very much. All right.
right, thank you. Can you follow that, Ava, in our report from the SGO?
I don't even think so. So first off, the SGO wanted to talk about our acoustic cafe, which we have coming up in May. Formerly known as Battle of the Bands, we had an acoustic cafe this December, which went really well. And with the help of Mr. Wankel, we're working on planning one for the spring. Right now we have the date May 29th, probably around 6:30. And we're going to do more of like a barbecue-themed acoustic cafe, hoping to get more turnout. We have a sign-up sheet for everything as hamburger buns to plates to napkins, that kind of thing. And we're working on getting a lot of volunteers, too, to hopefully have a big turnout. And to bring attention to this and more people performing, we have our musicians playing instruments over the intercom to grab the attention of the students and anyone who's interested in participating. So looking to do that early May to start playing music and just having the whole school be able to hear what's going on in our music department and what our students are capable of. We were also planning our plastic-free lunch, which is coming up April 19th, which is a Friday. There was a presentation from the Environmental Club to the SGO, and they were asking for funding, and we decided to ask for the necessities for the fundraiser before we agreed to anything. We're working on collecting facts to put onto posters that will bring attention to the plastic-free lunch, and also putting on the announcements. Just bringing it to everyone's attention, because I'm sure you know it's not really like a switch that you can turn on and off when it comes to using plastic, especially in schools and in the homes. So it's more of just bringing awareness until eventually it fades away and hopefully sticks. Then we have our SGO elections. We haven't done any of them yet, but we're working on starting with the SGO itself, then working on the senior class, then the junior class, working backwards to freshmen. Right now the debate is between having an actual speech for the candidates, a two-minute speech, or having a Google slide where the students write out their presentation, and that would be put along the TVs, like the televisions that we have through the hallways. I mean, I voted for the speech, but you can tell that a lot of the students probably wouldn't want to do that, especially the incoming freshmen. So that's the vote right now, and that's everything that's going on. As far as school-wide concerns, from what I've been hearing, everyone's just really excited about the opening of our new high school entrance. It's not officially open yet, but we've been able to see it now because they've taken down the interior, and everyone's just excited to see the progress and where it's going to end up.
That's great. I got to tell you, the prom was amazing.
Oh, really? Yes. I didn't get the chance to go. I was out, but yeah, I did. I heard great things.
It was amazing. All right. Sounds good. Thank you. Next is Dr. Z. I believe he will maybe give us some updates on how we're going to handle the election.
Yes. Yeah. And I want to take a minute to thank Trustee Russo too for everything you've done, you know, for 5 years for me, three as assistant, soup, two as soup, and you know, and I think back to my greatest teachers. They were the ones who asked those hard questions, really got me to think about things that I hadn't thought about. Also in committee meetings where I thought I had this great new idea and Trustee Russo let me know that actually we did that three times 10 years ago. I was like, oh, I thought I had one. But thank you seriously for everything. And on behalf of me, Jamie, and Carol, thank you for everything you've done to make us better. Us as a team, the community, and the schools, certainly. Thank you. I'll lead with that. We did have two open seats on the board for our election on May 21st. Now we will have three. And the way it works is in order of ranking, the person who gets the third most votes would take Trustee Russo's seat and finish till the end of her original term, which would end next year. And so that's the process. I mean, it was explained to us with a lot more language than that. This can't be, but it's after a few hours, that's what it came down to. But we'll be, you know, explaining that, posting that. Candidate petitions are due on Monday, April 22nd. Me and Ms. Campy will be in the office that day. The office is open at 5 p.m. in person. I had a few other announcements.
At 5 p.m.
Closes at 5 p.m., yep. A few other announcements. As you might have heard, there's a solar eclipse on Monday, and we have some solar eclipse glasses that we've given our trustees, and all students and staff will be receiving them tomorrow or Monday. we did have to face that decision if we're going to close early or not. Only six districts in Nassau County are closing early. So we aren't going to close early. We might make some adjustments to sports in the afternoon. Mr. Lang and I will be making an announcement about that. And we're excited. Mr. Menchel and Dr. Smythe and our principals have been working on great learning experiences, announcements in the elementary schools. And certainly our science classes have been doing a lot of great lessons. So we're excited for that. It starts at 2:12. It reaches maximum coverage at 3:26 p.m. And maximum coverage for us down here on Long Island is about 85 to 90%. The full eclipse, the total eclipse, is upstate. So you might know some people who are driving up there on Sunday this weekend. And then it will end at 4:37. I wanted to share with you today that we learned from Ms. Dahlia Rodriguez, who's here this evening, that we have been designated a Best Communities for Music Education award winner for the eighth year in a row. So I want to thank Ms. Rodriguez for that. It's by no accident. Ms. Rodriguez and her department totally exemplifies the North Shore dedication to consistent improvement in everything she does and everything her department does. You saw it last night with the dance symposium, which was amazing. Not only the dance performers, but the collaboration with all of the ensembles, students performing, singing at the same time as students were dancing was amazing. And of course, the prom, which was a week and a half ago, an amazing musical production. Of announcements, I wanted to announce that this year we have two National History Day contest participants going to New York State to compete. And Kelly's exhibit on IVF in the junior division and Metapolio in the Red Summer Race Riots in the senior division. They'll be going to Oneonta, New York this weekend to compete. So best of luck and thank you to Mr. Gordon, Mr. Dayhill, and Mr. T, the middle school, and all of our social studies faculty, of course. CASA and the North Shore School District will be having a joint parent university and town hall meeting where we're going to discuss the results of the Bach-Harrison survey, which was just given before the February break, and we're going to talk openly about how we can work together to address some of these issues. It'll take place 2 weeks from tonight in the middle school library right here, and we're going to do a hybrid event, so it'll be on Zoom, but you can come in person as well. Two more announcements. We finished our UPK lottery. I'm happy to announce that we found a seat for everyone who was registered, which is great news. We have an amazing partners in both Scope and in the YMCA. Liberty Ledesma and the whole Y team has been amazing, and they're helping us out. We're adding a class at Glenwood Landing this year, so we'll have two classes at each elementary school, a class at the Y, and then Liberty always helps us to find extra seats if we need it. So we're in really great shape. And Seth Gordon and Dr. Smythe have been great partners in helping to make the program better, and we look forward to more enhancements this year. And finally, last but not least, I want to thank Ms. Cashman, who's been helping us to organize for our plastic-free lunch day on Friday, April 19th, in honor of Earth Day, which is April 20th, with the support of the Coalition to Save Hempstead Harbor. Port Washington Schools is also participating in this. And we've just gotten great collaboration with our teachers, our principals, and Alan Levin, our food service director. And that's why you see we have our reusable water jugs. I'm trying to drink more water. And between that and the solar glasses, you can't lose, right? Okay. So those are all our announcements. Thank you, and thank you again, Trustee Russo.
All right. And we also have students being recognized tonight. So Dr. Z and Carol Dr. Smythe will go to the podium. If your child is being recognized, you're welcome to stand up, take as many pictures as you want. Feel free. And we're going to really try to hold the applause till the end, right, tonight?
Yeah, and we'll kind of direct you because we have different groups going up. So at the end of each group. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you.
Thank you for your patience, parents. So the first group of award winners we're going to recognize tonight are for our All County Art exhibit. All County Art exhibition features the work of K-12 art students in Nassau County who have demonstrated excellence in a wide variety of two-dimensional visual art forms, including drawing, painting, printmaking, and photography. This year, 27 North Shore student artists were represented in this exhibition, and Sabrina Choi was our Art Supervisors Association Scholarship recipient. Congratulations to all of our artists. I'm going to ask Ms. Rodriguez to come up to help us present. Thank you. You're always here, Ms. Rodriguez. Thank you so much. So our groups will be schools, so I'm going to ask for each school if you could hold the applause until we're done with the school, and that would be great. So we're going to start with the GHS, Glenhead School, Nora DiMiola, Luca Grella, and Chloe Lim. Please come up. I like that, Ms. Newman. I'm going to use that. Bop, 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 bop. All right. Glenwood, the mighty Glenwood Landing, our biggest elementary school. Paul Daly, Vivian Oakley, and Catherine Tarasi. Please come up. Seacliff School, Max Cashman, Paul Mencken, and Stella Schneidermesser. Please come up. Okay, our Vikings in the middle. Emma D'Alessandro, Nikki Fu, Rhea Ganashi, Augustina He, Ava Kim, Charlotte Pasuelo, Charlene Pang, Annalise Gamagas, and Yarabella Yang. Please come up. and high school students, please feel free to come up when I call your name, but we'll hold the applause till the end. And some of these students could not make it tonight. Elle Archer, Sabrina Choi, Luke Dixon, Ariel Escobar, Jessica Konarska, Victoria Konarska, Greg Nemirov, Polina Semenko, and Mina Stickley. Okay, now we're going to recognize our high school writing fellowship. It is with extreme gratitude that we honor the service of the school year 23-24 North Shore High School Writing Fellows. Director of Literacy and ELA, Julie Ritter, commends our 12th grade fellows with the following comments. The writing fellowship is a unique position, one that requires not only an exemplary academic ability, but also a profound commitment to elevating others. As fellows, these students create comfortable spaces for their peers, inviting them to collaborate in one-on-one discussions about their writing, their own writing process. By harnessing their exemplary skills to cultivate the talents of their peers, the writing fellows embody our vision of school as a community of learners. These selfless 12th graders celebrate their strengths, the strengths of the students they encounter, and inspire both their sense of security and their ability to craft their own writing evolution. The writing process is an invaluable tool for learning. It facilitates that vital interaction with information that allows students to access, assess, and express ideas. Thank you, writing fellows, for empowering your classmates to use writing with increasing confidence and ability. Thank you for helping to give their ideas a voice. And I want to thank not only Julie Ritter, but our faculty who work in the Writing Center. It's just an amazing place of service, of teaching, of modeling by our teachers and our students for our younger students. And I'm going to ask if you come up one by one, but we try to hold our applause to the very end. Hannah Bombardieri. Sophia Brandamarte. Caitlin Correa, Nora Davidson, Veronica Frank, Nico Giannakis, Millie Hilo, Taylor Klein, Jessica Leonard, Sophia Marchioli, Charlotte Marchioli, Christopher Marinello, Sophia Martini, Michaela McBride, Shay McDonald, Samantha Nelson, Alina Olakolova, Sienna Pereca, Mia Persibali, Paul Parakis, Robin Spieler, Henry Spina, Lily Tipton, Connie Zhang, and Julian Zazulo. Thank you so much, everyone, and congratulations.
Okay, all right, very good. Thank you, everyone, for coming. We're going to keep it moving here. We're now going to move to the approval of the minutes. This is for the March 14th meeting. Are there any comments or amendments to the minutes?
Good job, Betty, as usual.
Yeah.
Always so impressive.
None. Hearing no comments. The minutes will be accepted as is. Action 7, the Treasurer's Report from February 2024. Do I have a motion?
Motion.
Second?
Second.
Any questions, comments? All in favor? Okay, excellent. Action 8, the approval of budget transfers. Do I have a motion?
Motion.
Okay, I heard a second. Questions, comments? All in favor? Excellent. Thank you. We're now going to move to our regular business. We're going to be continuing our budget review tonight, right, Dr. Z?
That's right. So we do have a presentation on kind of a summary of where we are, a summary and a synthesis of what we gathered from the listening sessions, the What Makes Us Us meetings, and also other feedback that we've gotten independent of those meetings. And also, Mr. Pappas will speak to us tonight about, like we do every year, about the three-part budget and contingency budgets should we need it. So everybody has a hard copy of the presentation, and so you're welcome to stay here or you can move out there. Either is fine, whatever you're comfortable with. We're going to get set and we'll go up and use the screen. Thank you. Okay, so believe it or not, this is budget presentation number 5 this year, and where it's kind of a final presentation before the budget adoption, which is on April 16th. And what Mr. Pappas, Dr. Smythe, and I have tried to do is to synthesize what we came across from this whole year, but also the meetings that we've had over the past month. We've had 5 meetings called What Makes Us Us, What Keeps Us Us. It was a short presentation, but then we also asked parents either in person or on Zoom to put questions and thoughts and comments in the chat to just give us a lot of ideas. We had a lot of good participation, especially on the Zoom, and we're going to continue to explore that as we go into the future budget meetings before the actual budget vote in later April and in May. Because in those comment sections, the chat on Zoom, we would get pages and pages of comments that we can download and that we could use for further reflection. So very helpful, and we'll continue to use that. We met with elementary parents. We had, I think, over 170 elementary parents. We met with high school parents in person and did hybrid. I think we had close to 60 or 70 parents there. We had middle school parents. We were over, I think we were close to 100 on that meeting. We had in-person meetings with business owners and community members. And then, you know, throughout this past month, we've gotten a lot of feedback through email and through conversations, just informal conversations that we've had. So some themes emerged, and I wanted to mention those themes with Mr. Pappas and also just talk about some of our thinking around those themes. Theme one that we gathered, and some of these probably will resonate with us all because they're very North Shore themes. It's what it kind of reflected back, but with some surprises. Class size and close relationships are very important to parents. We started these meetings just with the open-ended question, what do you like about your experience at North Shore? Even to the business owners, you know, what do you like about, you know, operating your business here? And then, you know, we got to a place of, well, what would you change? What would be the new ideas? How does that relate to the budget? Really trying to get more feedback before the budget was finalized than in previous years. And we know that that's a common theme. Parents and students and teachers feel very close to their to each other, and students are well known by faculty. There's a lot of informal mentoring that happens on a daily basis. Faculty and staff are readily accessible and communicative. Student needs are met with precision. Students are just known well not only as a person but as a learner. And that those are definitely trademarks that came out and trademarks we know of in North Shore education. You know, and one thing that came up in the conversation was that of class size. We do talk about how at North Shore we have lower class sizes. Every year, Nassau County publishes a study through BOCES of class sizes. And at the elementary level, K through 6. And we don't participate in the sixth grade part because that's for K through 6 elementary schools. But what you can say here is, yes, we do have small class sizes, but they're not that far off from the Nassau County average. You know, in kindergarten, you see 16 versus 19 in the county average. I can tell you that kindergarten number is going to be bigger next year. We're getting a lot of, I don't know if it's because of the UPK or what, but we have a bigger kindergarten coming next year. Catherine Mill is a very busy registrar. But as you get into the middle grades, you can see that it's much closer to the county average of the 52 districts. One thing to consider is that further cuts or budget failures would lead to collapsing class sections and increases in class sizes. So, you know, in our budget planning, we are trying to maintain what we have as best we can, and opting for bigger classes at the secondary level in an effort to preserve our program overall. And that's been the approach. Talk more about that in a little bit. Theme two, parents had questions about classes with low enrollment and were also worried about specialized programs being eliminated. We have specialized programs like the IPA program, an independent art portfolio class, which is a mentoring of our teachers with a small number of students. Those are projects that we would want to preserve and that parents were concerned about those being eliminated. Sometimes we have small classes as a result of allowing our students to choose whatever they want and make sure that they can take it in any given year. So for example, if we wanted to offer a psychology class, we could just offer two sections and some kids would be blocked out of it. But if we offered three, that would allow all students to take it at different times during the day. And that has always been the North Shore way. And that goes hand in hand with, you know, we have no roadblocks for getting into honors classes. Something I'm very envious of as a parent in another district. And we have an open enrollment policy for all honors classes in the high school. We let students take any class they want to challenge themselves. That goes for honors classes or elective classes. And, you know, I'm a firm believer in that, into my core as an educator, as a late bloomer myself. You know, a lot of our students reach their prime at age 15 or 16, and too often educational systems make decisions about ability at age 10, 11, 12, or even younger. Our system doesn't lock them in to those choices. We're an anti-tracking system, proud of it, but we do our best to meet those needs. What we are doing this year is Dr. Smythe and I took a very hard, close look at section counts, course requests, and for the first time in many years, central office made direct decisions in conjunction with the high school, but the first decisions about how many sections would run for each course. And that was for many reasons, to maintain efficiencies, to make sure that the cuts we were already proposing would work. We wanted to make sure that would actually work. We wanted to offer another business, another business teacher, because the course requests for business were off the charts, and we had another teacher's worth full of business course requests. So we did that by finding efficiencies in other sections. So we'll talk later about cutting 9 positions. There really is a 10th position that we phased out into a business position within the current budget. It won't cost the district additional money than what we're already spending. So, and that's something we've talked about over the last 2 years. It's not only about cutting, but it's about repurposing. It's about finding new opportunities within the resources we already have. But the big change this year, and it is, you know, it is hard to then run a master schedule at the high school when you have fewer sections because there are fewer options for kids. And so while we will see some bigger classes at the high school, we'll also see students maybe have to wait another year or until spring to take an elective, and that is a change. But programs are intact. Theme 3, we had a great conversation with a small group of business owners. I really want to have more of these meetings. They were a wonderful group, tremendously honest group, but it was honest, but it wasn't cutting. It was friendly, it was partner-oriented, but they gave us their real thoughts, which is what we wanted. We wanted to know, and it's a question that we need to ask more. How does the whole tax structure, what's happening with LIPA and industry here, how is that affecting you as a small business owner? We did talk about that, but we actually talked a lot about how they can work with our students in an educative fashion. Internships in their businesses, how they can come into our schools. You know, we're in a small community. We have really multiple small communities together in one small central school district. There are so many opportunities in Seacliff, in Glenhead, in Glenwood Landing, in Greenvale. All of these local businesses, they can partner with us and support our students. That's true authentic learning. So we're looking forward to those possibilities. I want to thank Courtney Sitko, Terrence, the owner of COCO, and the Gold Coast Business Association for all of their work in setting up this meeting, and we want to keep having those meetings. Theme 4, parents of students with special needs and special programming were concerned about the continuation of programs. So our special education population, parents were concerned about that. When you hear about budget cuts, is special education going to be cut? Is our programs for English language learners going to be eliminated? We have not only a legal mandate, but a moral mandate to continue those programs. And so while there will be no impact on students, we are repositioning some special education positions, but in a way, because of population changes and class size changes, there'll be no impact on student program. We are doing a special education review. We're going to be talking to parents. We're going to be sending out a survey to parents and teachers, staff. We're going to be interviewing staff, interviewing parents over the next month. And in our early May meeting, we're going to be presenting that to you. That's not a budget-focused effort, but I do think there will be some implications of that review on the programs we offer in an effort to make them better for students. But as we mentioned in one of our previous meetings, we have a very high percentage of students who are classified with an educational disability. 17% of our students have an IEP. About another 7% have a 504 plan, a Section 504 plan, which doesn't offer direct services, but requires that teachers and the school provide accommodations like extra time, preferential seating, so on and so forth. Our report, by the way, in May, will go over these very basic definitions, because I think one thing I found when we talk about English language learners and special education is that what special education even is confusing. It means something different to different people, so we're going to dig down into those very basic definitions. Another thing, and it's a great thing, our community is becoming more diverse. We have more English language learners, as do most communities. We were a little late to the game because we're on this peninsula out here, isolated a little bit up in North Shore, but it's happening now, and that means we need to serve those students, again, the legal and the moral mandate, through additional English language learner resources. So, you know, this is an interesting situation with this theme because these needs are growing. The numbers are growing. We have more referrals to special education every year. We have more English language learners every year. Those are growing costs. That is a big portion of the special education part of the differential in costs for additional teachers versus other districts that you saw in the budget study. This is a big contributor to that. And I'm certainly not complaining of that. On the contrary, I'm proud of that. But that there's a why there, and that is it. And those numbers are going up. So that's, you know, a conundrum in this situation where we're trying to hold costs flat. We're not adding any additional new staff to this budget. and yet we have those needs are growing. And so that's an example of the tension that we're working within. Theme 5, parents were appreciative of the special experience within the North Shore schools. And we did do a little bragging in those meetings, but the parents did it themselves often. Our elementary schools are the best, amongst the best in New York State. So there are about 2,800 to 2,900 elementary schools in New York State. One of our elementary schools is ranked number 14. One of them is a Blue Ribbon recognized school. The other two have been recognized in the top 15 or in the top 100. We have some of the highest outcomes in mathematics in New York State every year and in literacy. We have engaging and assured experiences in STEM, world language, and school-wide enrichment. That means all students get those experiences. It's not a grab or a competition to get into school-wide enrichment. Everybody gets it. We do have some specialized programs within that, but everybody gets it. Everybody gets STEM, and it's done by a STEM teacher, a science teacher with an engineering background. Very specialized instruction, and it shows. Superior reading and math intervention and special education services, one of the few districts that has instrumental music starting in third grade, numerous club and authentic learning experiences, and our UPK program. And I do want to mention that because not only is it a great thing, I'm very proud of the encouragement that our board gave us to really take advantage of those grant monies. Those grant monies from New York State, basically the state gives us $5,400 per student. They're not easy to use because private pre-Ks cannot take that amount. They just can't operate on that margin from an income perspective. And they really were trying to work with us. But we found partners in scope in the YMCA, and we're offering 7 classes next year. When you think of the 130 students that we're serving next year and the 108 students or so we serve this year, that's over $1 million in each year that we're saving parents in private pre-K costs. So we're proud of that, we're proud of the program, and we're looking forward to continuing to improve it. North Shore Middle School, out of about 1,800 middle schools in New York State, ranked number 22. 4 languages in grade 6, unique assortment of electives. That's one thing that is very unique about our middle school. We're tightening that up. We're having a quality over quantity discussion. It's still going to be a very rich set of offerings, but we are looking at quality over quantity. We're moving to a 4-quarter system next year, most likely. We're looking into that. We have a wide assortment of athletic teams and intramurals, a wide assortment of clubs. We have teaming and lab periods for all students. We have a wellness center. We have an advisory program every morning. We have expansive special ed programs like all the other schools. In 8th grade, every student takes a coding class. So again, universal experiences in STEM. And we have science research and National History Day programs as well. And North Shore High School, ranked 43 out of 1,400 high schools in New York State, number 8 on Long Island. We have multiple college level programs. We have offerings in the arts, music, and athletics, STEM and research offerings, expansive special education, academic supports, competitive college admissions. I think when we talk about that this year, you'll see our students did very well this year in terms of their college admissions. Every year is different. We've learned to appreciate that, but this was a strong year for North Shore, and a vast offering of clubs at North Shore High School. Six, residents were interested in new forms of revenue generation. One thing we've been talking about since last year is how we need to generate new revenue to ease the burden of relying on tax revenue and also to help make up the shortfall. Despite the fact that we're making cuts, we need to keep up. And just cutting programs and cutting staff cannot be our only weapon in this fight that we have. We have been actively lobbying and advocating for additional state aid. As I've said before, I visited Albany. Our teachers union has helped to advocate directly with the state senate for that the return of that $1 million grant that Jim Gorin, Senator Gorin, used to give us. We're constantly in touch with our assemblyman, Assemblyman Levine, and Senator Martins. We have started to experiment with raising tuition and fees on the use of our facilities. We have an ABA program, specialized special ed program in Seacliff, that is bringing in a few hundred thousand dollars of tuition. And it's also allowing us to keep our students here who might otherwise be going to an out-of-district placement for special education services. We need to work on more grant writing and fundraising. And we need to explore commercial development. We've been starting to meet with folks who are interested in developing in this community. We're working towards, our LAC committee is working towards meeting with the IDA, the Industrial Development Agency, that handles decisions on taxes and tax abatements and tax breaks for new development. We're working to develop that relationship. So we're becoming more active. Through the Legislative Action Committee, and I'd say the Revenue Generation Committee here, which is a new committee this year, to start thinking about how we can ramp up these efforts. And just a review of kind of what we did this year that connects to both budget cuts and revenues. We started the year with a $7.5 million deficit. And that's not because of anything we hadn't done, but that is a deficit, the kind of deficit that all districts are facing. And I'll talk about tax levies in other districts. A lot of districts are over 3% this year, many, many more than last year. And that's because health insurance alone, for a small district like North Shore, created a new $2 million cost that we have no control over. And then we had increases in transportation, special education. We also, and this is unique to North Shore, we lost $2.4 million from LIPA, 2.388 to be exact, and a $750,000 net amount of grant that we had normally received and relied on every year. So that becomes $7.5 million of a distance we needed to travel. We made we're proposing $2.5 million in budget cuts, and $1.5 million in a combination of increased use of reserves. We're using more reserves than ever. A little state aid and tuition from the new programs that we're starting. That leaves us with a $3.5 million tax levy. And finally, theme 7. There was a concern with the rise in cost of living, and the timing of cuts was important to those we heard from. So I would argue, and I think Mr. Pappas too, it's not just what we cut, which is so important to our students, but when we make cuts. And this board and this district for the last 10 or 15 years has mastered that approach to strategically making cuts and using reserves at the right time. Our argument is you need to make it like a corporation would at a time of economic uncertainty, at the point of the biggest drop-off. Otherwise, if you cut to the bone, and I'm going to talk about this a little bit more, you will have nothing left to cut from when the bottom drops out, and that is really important. That point alone, I cannot stress hard enough, will determine what happens with this school and with this community. And that is just so important, and we're going to talk about it a little bit more in a minute. So how have we tried to address this hard decision? Because I think that is what Trustee Russo said earlier. That is the burden that we're working within. You know, we have our students who have this program. We've made cuts. We also know it's expensive to live on Long Island in general. There's a macroeconomic environment that's hyperinflationary that schools or even local governments have little control over. But we also know that's affecting our residents, and taxes are another cost increase on top of that. So that is what we are trying to balance as best we can. We mentioned the UPK savings that we're hopefully saving residents, you know, over $1.25 million by offering them free UPK that's grant funded. That's not a tax increase either because that's grant funded directly. This budget includes $2.5 million in cuts right now. North Shore has the second lowest budget-to-budget increase in Nassau County, 1.9%. And so if we weren't losing the LIPA revenue, that stat would mean we'd have probably one of the lowest tax levies also. You know, when we back out what we're losing from LIPA, gets us close to zero in terms of the cuts we're making, the efficiencies we're finding. would get us close to a 0% levy, but it is the handling that bear of the LIPA loss, which we will not have next year, that is so difficult. And other districts who are in the 3%, you know, there are districts that have 3.92%, 3.74%, 3.55%, 3.45%. They're not dealing with LIPA, and their tax increases are that highest percentage, and actually more dollars than ours because they're bigger budgets. So, you know, that's just the point I want to lay out, that we are on the higher end, but we're with a lot of other districts that are there, and they have much bigger budget-to-budget increases. They're not making the sacrifices that we are, that we have to. There is a concern with cutting programs that would devastate the student experience and have a minimum impact on taxes. You know, that minimum might be a maximum to someone. I understand that is a matter of perspective, and I understand that minimum meaning, you know, if we cut $1 million out of this budget, it might save somebody a few hundred dollars. Like, that's what we're talking about. But that would also be 8 or 9 teachers. So that is what we are up against, that decision. And again, cutting to the bone now will leave the district with few options in the next few years and certainly in 2027, creating a devastating scenario. We want to have two things. The plan B to go to things that we have to cut. Parents were vociferous about, obviously, the elementary parents, about not wanting to have a Princeton plan approach now, but were more resigned to if it had to happen in 2027, they would at least not throw tomatoes at me immediately. they just said, we heard time and time again, wait until it's ultimately necessary. Again, that is a matter of perspective. We understand that. In our view, that is something we would like to prevent. And the other thing here is that giving ourselves a couple of years to generate new revenue, to get more state aid, to prevent having to do something like a Princeton plan is helpful too. But let's say we went to a Princeton plan this year. Let's say we closed the school this year. What on earth would we do in 2027? Would we have classes of 40? Would we have 3 schools instead of 5? You know, that's what, you know, so we have to have space to go to if that emergency happens. Additional state aid will be used to lower the tax levy, and this is really important. Mr. Pappas and I were really hoping we were going to have this number for you tonight, the new state aid. We were told it would be here today. Today, Mr. Pappas heard it's coming on Monday. So in typical fashion, these things are coming out late. We know that the state legislature is negotiating with Governor Hochul to try and restore state aid. I think probably most of us are aware of that. Any additional state aid that we get will be used to lower the tax levy. We'll recommend that to the board to do that. We don't know. We don't have a guesstimate on that, but we're hoping that, you know, there are some factors there. For example, the governor used a different inflation number, not the actual inflationary number when calculating the state aid. She used her office used a reduced number. We've heard that might change. They might use the actual inflation number, and so that might yield all of these districts more state aid, and we certainly hope for that. More points here before I turn it over to Mr. P. There was a concern with the rising cost of living and some other themes under that. Course section numbers were assigned by central office with the budget in mind. So for the first year, we've done what other big central school districts do, not typical of North Shore. Carol and I, Dr. Smythe and I, looked at those course section requests ourselves, and we assigned section numbers. A little uncomfortable, a little awkward, not the way we normally do business. It's usually very organic with student needs, and the high school and Miss Imperial do an amazing job. They always have. But we're thinking from a budgetary perspective to make things work. So we're going to see some slightly bigger classes at the high school. We're running electives, but all electives and all programs, but we are not, you know, students might get blocked out of elective here and there in a way that they didn't in the past because we have fewer sections. But those fewer sections have allowed us to convert a position into a business teacher. They've allowed us to maintain everything that we have, which was our thinking going in. So just to sum up my portion here, the current draft budget includes cutting 9 teaching positions and 5 teacher aides. 14 positions. Last year, the total was 27. So that's 41 positions over 2 years, $5.2 million over 2 years. If more cuts were to be made now, elementary classroom sections would be cut and class sizes would increase at the elementary level. Secondary class sizes would also have to increase. Non-core programs would be or could be eliminated. Things like third grade music, instrumental music. And certainly, and this is what Mr. Pappas is going to talk to you about, we do this every year, an austerity budget would lead to an additional cuts of $3.5 million. So it would be the 2.5 and then another 3.5, so around $6 million total. So it would be an additional 30 teachers, 39 total, and the elimination of extracurricular and athletics programs and offerings if we went to a contingency budget. It's interesting, and some of you in this room will know, in the school year 2004-2005, North Shore operated on a contingency budget, and I actually found the letter that the superintendent at the time, Dr. Melnick, wrote to the community about this when it had happened in June of 2004. I debated whether I should bring it, but I'm already being long-winded. But it was very educative. Maybe at some point in a superintendent report I will read portions of it because it really educated me. We've been very lucky that we haven't had to do that. But when a risk of that is you know present, we have to be aware of what is on the table. So I tried really hard with this graph, but I don't know if it's clear or not. But basically what I was trying to demonstrate here is long-term strategic thinking. What this board and this district has done for over a decade is to, if they have gotten reserves or if they've gotten aid, they haven't just used it in 1 year and created a revenue hole. They've used it slowly over time. They've cut things slowly over time when it made sense, when there were retirements, and when they could find those efficiencies in the way that impacted students the least, but also made the best financial sense. And I think that's what we have here. We would argue that the current amount of cuts maintains our program, is super efficient, super tight. Mr. Pappas and I are literally counting the delta, the difference between a retiring teacher's salary and a new teacher's salary, and we're using that in our cash flow analysis for next year. That is how tightly we are budgeting. If we were to go to a bare bone, cut to the bone level this year, an austerity budget would force us to do that. I do not know what we would do in 2027 or in future years. You know, we could lose grant money next year, what we would cut next. And it would require a major reorganization. It would require major structural work. And I just think that is the kind of thing that parents and everyone needs to really think hard about what we want our schools to look like. Next year, we're losing less than we're losing this year. We're losing $2.4 million, $2.38 from LIPA, and we're losing a smaller amount next year. We level off to an $8.4 million amount that we could lose in 1 year from LIPA. Again, we don't know for sure, but we want to be prepared for that. So at the same time as we're, you know, making sure we have areas where we could restructure, could reorganize to save money, we're going to take the next two to three years to build up revenue streams and to continue to advocate for more state aid. And just to note, you know, North Shore, and again, I always say this when I show this chart, I'm in no way saying it's cheap to live on Long Island. It's, we all know the tri-state area in general, mostly New Jersey, Westchester, and Long Island, are the most expensive areas to live besides some areas on the West Coast. And what I am saying is relative to other districts, despite everything that's going on here with LIPA, our tax rate is still lower than a lot of neighboring towns. Syosset, East Williston, Jericho, great school districts. Bethpage, Roslyn, Hewlett, Plainview Old Bethpage. And a lot of those districts I just listed have tax levies in the low to mid 3% range. So their tax rates are higher than ours and their tax levies are just a little lower than ours. So just to wrap up, you know, we have tried to find this middle ground where Now, typically, if we weren't going through the LIPA piece and we didn't have this inflation, we would, in a typical year, we'd look to maintain what we have, maybe add a position if we needed it. We're in the noticing phase, which is where we think students will start to notice some of these changes with the budget, some more bigger class sizes, especially on the humanities side, loss of some aides and monitors. If we were to continue to cut, we believe that students would start to feel, or in the worst case scenario, be impacted by these changes. And so we're kind of in that yellow range of 3.96%. You see, if you continue to cut more, the impact of, for example, lowering the tax levy to 3.5% would be about 12 to 13 positions, 2.9 million, I'm sorry, 2.3, 1 million in the tax levy, and $455. So the difference of a cut of about $400,000 or $500,000 is about $60 to $65 on the tax bill. Of course, that's all an estimate. Continuing to go down to get the tax levy to 3% would be cutting 16 to 17 teachers. We would still have a tax levy of a 2.46 amount, and it would be another $60 off. So just the relationship to what we would need to cut to make an impact on the tax bill, there's a lot that would need to be cut to significantly lower that tax bill. So our goal is to maintain, again, we're shoveling snow while it's snowing. We're having hyperinflationary impacts, and that's why you're seeing, North Shore does not have the highest tax levy. Elmont does, 4.37%. We're at 3.96% right now. Plainview, Old Bethpage, 3.2. East Williston, 3.74. Westbury, 3.72. Port Washington, 3.55. Hicksville, 3.45. Great Neck, 3.26. Jericho, 3.25. East Meadow, 3.24. Syosset, 3.23. Roslyn, 3.07. None of those districts besides North Shore are losing millions of dollars due to LIPA, and yet they're all in the threes in terms of tax levy. I just think that's a very important point to pull out. It is expensive. We are doing our best, but we are facing something that is really, really devastating. I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Pappas.
So thank you, Dr. Zubionis. I wanted to get into the component budget. Back in 2002, the New York State required that budgets be broken down into three components. And the budgets that you have, and members of the public have seen, as detailed budgets, the codes that are associated with those do break that budget down into the three components. The first is the administrative component, the second is the program component, and the third is the capital component. Within the administrative component, it's all expenditures associated with the school board, the superintendent, the business office, legal costs, insurance costs, planning, the administration over the facilities department, the administration over the transportation department, district level curriculum, PD, that professional development that we would have, and things like that, as well as the administrative costs for BOCES. The program costs are the cost for the supplies for the students, those dealing directly with the students and teaching each day, the cost of the classroom, the cost of the teachers' salaries, special education costs, as well as the transportation, the cost of the buses, the bus drivers, not the administration, but the actual day-to-day cost to provide those services to the students. And finally, there's the capital component, which is all the expenses that relate to the day-to-day maintenance and upgrade of our facilities, as well as the debt service that goes into our upgrades. In 2019, the public approved a bond for $39 million, and the cost of that debt is all included within the capital component. So this is the approved component budget for 2023 and 2024, and our proposed component budget for 2024 and 2025 through 2025. It's a roughly a little over $2 million increase. There's a pie chart that shows the breakdown of the program component in relation to both the capital component and administrative components for the proposed budget. One of the things that we talk about and it was touched upon is a contingent budget. And what exactly is a contingent budget? Well, how do we get to a contingent budget? When the voters of a school district fail to approve a budget, the district has is required by law to fail a budget or vote down a particular budget, the board has three alternatives. The first is to put the same budget up for a vote. They could also change that budget and put it up for a second vote, or if that fails as well, or they could go directly to a contingent budget. And what exactly is a contingent budget? A contingent budget, if it's rejected a second time, the board would have to adopt a contingent budget, and the tax levy in a contingent budget can be no greater than the tax levy of the year before. So as we look at the revenues, it's really revenue driven. When we see the tax levy for 2023-24, it was $89 million. If you look at the final column, contingent budget, all the revenues are the same except for the tax levy. So we'd roll the same revenues over, but we'd have to go with a tax levy of roughly $89 million. That would create a budget of $119 million, considerably less than even what the budget was last year. And the reason I draw that distinction is we still have the increase in costs, the increase in health insurance, the contractual obligations, increase in salaries. They still come forward in the new budget. But now we have to fund that budget with considerably less money at the $119 million. We see at the bottom the maximum levy where we were in 2023-24. We were about $1.5 million below what we could have levied. In the next year, we're also about $1.5 million lower than in the proposed budget what we could have levied. In the contingent budget, the most we can levy is, as I mentioned, the same levy as what was passed last year. So what does that mean in terms of the ramifications? We would have to cut in a contingent budget, as Dr. Zublionis mentioned, over $3.5 million more, potentially impacting academic programs, because what a contingent budget says is you can only budget for those things that are necessary and contingent in the instructional program. It also includes health and safety, and in those cases, you would have to make cuts. As I mentioned, the costs, the increase, those budget drivers that we're seeing this year, health insurance, salaries, all of those things are still there. They don't go away. So the only way to offset that is to make major cuts, and that would be to academic programs. As Dr. Zublionis mentioned, reduction of staff, cutting of teaching positions, maybe getting rid of athletic and extracurricular programs. This is what many districts have done when faced with a similar situation. Eliminating field trips, eliminating some of those things that, while are great from an educational standpoint, don't fall into the definition of the basic needs in terms of the education. No purchase of new equipment, that would be computers, that would be everything, including some of those items that we've had put in the budget, maybe a school bus or things like that. Those would all have to be eliminated. Under a contingent budget, community members could not use the fields. If it creates a cost for the district, then people would argue, well, we still have to mow the lawns, we still have to clean up, we still have to do those things. That's a cost to the district. So many times in these contingent budgets, one of the things that also is eliminated is the use of facilities by community organizations. And finally, any construction projects that we would have in the current budget would have to be eliminated. So this is a breakdown of the contingent budget under comparing it to what our administrative component is, both last year, the proposed budget, and the preliminary contingent budget. Now, those numbers could change between the two, but there are certain restrictions, what you would have to reduce your administrative costs by, the things that you would need to eliminate under the capital component, and those are currently built into that. So there would be a considerable reduction in the program component even here, as well as a considerable reduction in the administrative component, professional development, all of those things, and about a $500,000 reduction in any of our capital expenditures. So it would be something that certainly when we talked about feeling and not feeling and where we would be, it would be quite devastating to come to that point. And certainly would change the look of what we see every day.
Just one observation as you were talking there, Mr. Pappas. I think when you get to the point of a contingency budget, the decisions are kind of made for you by state law and by state regulation. It's almost like taken out of our hands as a local community as to what we can spend on. I think, it's so many of these costs. By the way, the 3.5 would be on top of the 2.5, so it would be $6 million total. So many of these costs are outside of our control. They're based on wage increases. Yes, those were negotiated years ago, but they're within range. We saw in the budget report comparison, we're in the median salary range, health insurance, things that are mandated to go up. So when you see a budget go up, it's hard for me to say, but we are not adding anything. We're cutting and it's going up, and that's because of how hyperinflationary it is. And that was the same last year, and that's the same across, I'd say, the country, but especially the tri-state area, and that's why you're seeing this. And it's all because if we could choose to not have a $2 million health insurance cost, we would choose to not do that. I'm sure we will see in the forthcoming years some kind of different approach to us working together as districts to bring those costs down. I'd say a good comparison to school budgets going up, if you look over the past 20 years, you might say, oh, they're going up, they're adding more, they're wasting money. Look at hospitals. It's the same trajectory. They have the same number of patients, but their costs are going up because the cost of doing everything is going up, and they have no control over that. We're trying to exercise the control we do have and still maintain the program that our kids have, albeit a little more efficiently, to be honest with you. Bigger classes at the high school, some fewer electives for some of our kids. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that presentation. Design a budget and move the equipment. we have great schools here, and it is really frightening to think that if this budget goes down, the schools as we know them will be radically changed. And, it's scary on so many levels. It's scary in terms of how that would impact our student programming, our instruction, how that would impact the human capital that we have here at North Shore that we love, how it would impact all the extras, right? Athletics and performing arts and our mental health services that we offer. And, of course, how it would impact housing values. We know there's been research done, we've cited it before, where every dollar that is spent on schools equates to about $20 in your housing values. And I guess as you were talking, I was thinking, we talk so much about what makes us us, and a contingency budget really eliminates all of it. So I know today we're going to go line by line through the remaining sections. We're going to start with staffing, and we wanted to know, are there any updates to that? Everyone listening at home, all of the information that we're going through is available on board docs, so everything's transparent, and you can follow along with us.
So right now we have the same staffing recommendations. You know, we continue to look at opportunities if there were additional retirements. But I think what we're doing is, like I said earlier, we are having increases in certain needs and we're not adding staff. And that's, you know, so that's, you know, still the 9 faculty position cuts, as well as 5 monitor or teacher aide positions that we've been talking about in the budget presentations we've had thus far.
Any questions from trustees on that? Okay, let's look at the commercial insurance, which is section D12, 1910 through 1981. Again, it's all posted on board docs. Questions?
I had one. It's actually, I didn't realize just by the title of this section that our split properties are actually in this category.
You just reminded me. I forgot. I'm supposed to read that. The district's general and commercial liabilities, as well as BOCES administrative and capital costs, are expected to increase between 12% and 15% next year. The district is a member of the New York Schools Insurance Reciprocal and experiences some protection from the high costs in commercial insurance market. But this year, the business office was informed to expect higher increases next year due to storm-related and cyber claims nationwide. The BOCES costs are determined by Nassau BOCES. The increases are mainly due to the rising costs of health insurance, which are passed on to all component districts. Thank you, Maria.
Actually, I remember reading that article in the NYSER newsletter that warned us about the increases, too. I mean, this is something that your presentations illustrate so well, is we're just helpless in those categories. But I was curious on the split properties that we are lowering. I'm sorry. I just want to clarify first. Our proposed budget is lower by $16,000 on the split properties. Is that is the money that we are getting from other districts?
Correct. In those instances where a district, where a homeowner's property falls in both the North Shore School District and one of our neighboring districts, that the individuals have the choice, the homeowner has the choice to send their students to either district. They get to choose. Even if it's only a few feet, they get to choose. In those cases, we then bill that district for the tax revenue that they would have gotten from that homeowner, the school tax revenue that they would have gotten from that homeowner. This represents that there are less of those, meaning the students have either graduated or grown, but they're anticipated less students in that split property area than a prior year.
Thank you. I guess I think you just answered. I was wondering how you could know that, but it's, I mean, you certainly know about the graduates.
Yes.
That's probably
and
a big,
people who have moved or
right,
or
and
have maybe select were going here when we were billing and selected to go back to their original district or private school or something from another neighboring school district.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
I'm not sure if you can answer this off the top of your head. I'm sorry I didn't ask in advance. The iPads and Chromebooks insurance, is that, does any of that, correct me if I'm wrong, do the parents pay any amount into that? I can't remember if I'm imagining this or not. Do we cover that insurance?
We cover that insurance.
Okay.
They do pay for the initial deposit when they get the Chromebook, and depending on how many times, if it has to be replaced a certain number of times over the years, that number goes up, but the insurance itself is paid for by the district.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions? All right.
Okay. I was just going to point out that's a question, that's an area, that a line item that we often look at, because so many of us in the community, as well as a few of us on the board, wonder if we need to be providing so many Chromebooks to every single student, right? We talk about, but I would imagine, given that amount is $21,000 rounding up, if even if we didn't, if we suddenly stopped giving Chromebooks to K-1 or K-2 students, we're not saving anywhere near, you know, more than chump change in that.
Be a small decrease. Yeah. I think that would be a good little analysis for us to do, like overall, because I think what the savings would come from, a little bit from there, from the technology code, you would have like little savings that add up. And there's more and more research on reasons to do what you're saying.
Let's keep it moving. Employee benefits. Employee benefits account for more than 25% of the budget. It includes, I mean, take that in for a second. It includes pension costs for teachers, administrators, and teacher assistants in TRS, pension costs for all support staff in ERS, and the district's share of Social Security, Medicare taxes, workers' compensation, unemployment, health, life, and dental insurance. The district's contribution rate, which is set annually by TRS, is estimated to be 9.76% in 24-25, while the average employer contribution rate for ERS, which is set by the New York State Comptroller, is anticipated to be between 9.75 and 10.25% for fiscal year 24-25. Health insurance costs are expected to increase by approximately $1.6 million next year, or approximately 9%. This is the result of the NYSHIP Empire Plan rate increase in 2024, as well as projected increases for 2025. So, any questions here?
My only question, and I think I did ask this in advance, but just for the public, is I was wondering when we find out for sure what that percentage is. And I think it's July, is that right?
And that's correct. I had put in my narrative that the number was somewhere between 9.5% and 10%, and the most recent estimate that's on the website is 10.02%. So it's just at that 10%. We'll get, when they release the actuarial study, usually in July, we'll get a more definitive what that number is. But
I was hoping it would be like 9.5 or something, and we'd have some extra money to play with here, but I guess not.
Public should know, Vice President Colasiopa had a whole career in the insurance industry.
I did. Before I retired, that's what I did. I was an account director at a managed care company, and my clients were big insurance companies like GHI. Now, then she changed to Emblem Health, but yes, I mean, I wish I could do something about NYCHIP and lower the rates for us.
I just want to, I think, point out, but verify that this is another example. Dr. Z talked earlier about how you are so careful with the numbers that you are looking at the differential between, you know, a new employee and a retiring one in terms of salary. This is another area where you are going employee by employee almost, right? And
yes,
calculating.
We do go employee by employee.
Right.
So.
And it's complicated by the difference in how the year, the 6 month period, right, is in one budget year, and the other 6 months is in the other budget year.
Especially
right?
With health insurance,
you don't
they
find
adjust
out
the rate mid-year. So
right.
There is an estimate of where we think we will be for the second half of next year. We won't know that until middle of December. They tell us what the new rate will be. And we try to anticipate what that will be.
It's just staggering when you look at it. Like if you go look at all the budget lines there, the healthcare, you know, from it was in 2021, that actual expenditure, $13 million, now $19 million. We actually have fewer employees. We've made cuts. We have fewer employees, and it's gone up. You know, we've got 50 employees.
All right.
Such a big chunk of what you've just presented to us. It's huge.
Other questions on this section?
A lot of discussion, I think, in our last meeting about revenue, right? I mean, I had all sorts of notes, but they're all the same, so I'm not going to repeat them.
I'm going to move on to debt service. Oh, here we go. The district borrows money from financial institutions to build, renovate, or purchase large fixed equipment and pays it back over time. Debt service in this part of the budget covers the principal and interest on serial bonds, interest costs on bond anticipation notices, and on tax anticipation notices. TANs are short-term notes that are used to meet the district's cash flow needs before taxes are collected from the county. This budget includes debt service for permanent financing of phase one of the 2019 bond projects and both interest and principal on bands and serial bonds for the remaining projects. Any questions or comments here? We're moving on. So revenue and financing sources, which is section A through 3. There wasn't any attachment for this, but I wanted to give trustees an opportunity, or if you wanted to say anything.
I just wanted to lead up. We were hoping to have that update on state aid for this tonight. It would have been the perfect time, New York State, if you're listening. And I know all districts and superintendents and business officials feel that way. So we are hopeful we'll get the news on Monday. And you know, we'll report that to the board quickly, and then at the next meeting, report it to the public.
Okay.
I do have one question, though, related. Thank you, Dr. Z. You mentioned, of course, any additional state aid will be used to lower the tax levy. What are you thinking in terms of, at this point, is there any hope for the $1 million grants that you had come away from Albany with some optimism, but of course we don't know, we're still early from the state perspective, we're still early in that budget process, right? We might not know about that till
June, yeah, right. Is what I've heard, but we do think it's still in the queue. We do think they're considering it.
And in the Senate and one in the Assembly, right?
That's correct.
Okay.
Are there questions or comments?
I have a comment. It's only 9:37. I want to just thank you for that presentation, because I think even though it was our fifth budget presentation, I still feel like there was more new information there that was really helpful. And just, you know, it's a never-ending task I see for you. So, you know, and I know you compared us to other districts on Long Island, and, you know, if you look at all of Long Island, including Nassau and Suffolk, we are 11th, we're not second, and there are four districts that are trying to pierce the tax cap, which I was, you know, shocked about. So it's, like you said, there are so many districts who are facing these same kind of issues that we have, but they are not losing LIPA. It's just, you know, a testament to the fact, a 1.9% budget-to-budget increase in this
environment,
thanks, that's the word I was looking for, is it just seems like, you know, an unthinkable, an unbelievable task that you have reached.
Like I just mentioned super quick, you know, one of the districts that's piercing the cap is a district I started working in close to where I grew up, and that's a good example of where they don't have a plan B, like we were talking about in this presentation. They are at the bone, and they're in trouble because of it, and so that's their only option. It's going to be hard, because they're trying to pierce the cap in a hyperinflationary environment.
We're still 2% under our tax cap, which, you know, there's an argument to be said that hurts us for next year because we can't go higher. But, I mean, obviously, we have the taxpayer in mind, and, you know, we are trying to keep it as low as possible.
All the districts that I mentioned, you know, who are in the threes, almost all of them are going up to their full cap. And those that aren't are not by like 0.05% or 0.1%.
I'm going to pick it back on that too with a few comments that I jotted down while we were listening to this. Actually, it is remarkable to think we've had five presentations. Each one has been better than the last. And even though we keep, you know, you're trying to present the information in very consistent but also new ways, I pick up on things that seem suddenly obvious that I think, how did I not get that before? So I just want to lay it out there in the event that it might help somebody else who's gone through a similar situation. Back to, you know, the uniqueness of our difficulty because of LIPA. we look at our $3.529 million tax levy, which is the 3.9% increase, taking away the LIPA amount of 2.4 would put us at only 1.1 million. And that's, you know, that's truly remarkable. And I think can't be said enough. and that, you know, you when you went through what the other percentage tax levy increases were, Dr. Z, you went fairly quickly, but the one I picked up on that I think was very close to ours was East Williston, 3.74. Interestingly, as you have pointed out to us many times, another district with no giant mall or giant utility helping pay the taxes, you know, largely residential situation just like ours, they're nowhere near, you know, our 1.9% budget-to-budget increase either. So just a few, you know, few things that I wanted to point out. Also, just to state the obvious, but sometimes I'm a little slow to cotton on to it, so I'm going to say it out loud. When you talked about the contingency budget, it is, of course, incredibly sobering. We're near the second to last page. Would require a reduction from the current proposed budget of $3,529,000, et cetera. That is, of course, the tax levy. The contingent budget means we cannot levy taxes. We must levy zero taxes. So, again, just stating the obvious. But
be a zero tax. It would be the same tax levy as last year. So
right.
We couldn't
increase
the levy.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Right.
No. But yeah.
Right. Yes, thank you. And then I did have one question. On the very last page from Mr. Pappas, when you talk about the component budget, can you clarify, if we just even just look at the administrative, the top one, a contingent budget this year for the administrative component would actually be lower than the approved, than what an approved component budget would have been for 23-24 last year. But, and so that difference, that, sorry, I don't even, you probably know the one I'm trying to ask better than I can trip over the words, but I'm trying to get at, that's dictated, that Dr. Z referred to this, these are cuts we must make that are dictated by state regulation.
Correct. In the specifically the administrative component can't be a higher percentage than the percentage it is for the combination of the administrative and program components for the last time you had a passed budget, meaning the 23-24. So if the administrative component in 23-24 was 12%, our administrative component for this year for a contingent budget can't be any more than 12% of that, of those same numbers.
Okay.
Therefore, the numbers are lower, the amount that the administrative component would be lower.
Thank you. Got it.
Further confuse things, but I...
No, it actually did clarify.
Confuse myself sometimes.
At least
I just... Oh, I'm sorry. I just wanted to say one last thing that I probably should have started with, but Lisa... referred to it as well, that just that despite this, the climate of financial strain that we're under and the sense of foreboding that gives us, I just want to thank you for reminding us what we accomplish every single day, that, you know, the bragging pages, as you call them, they are an amazing part of this, and what is driving us, you know, I think is driving you and certainly driving my sense listening to you of why this is a really excellent budget and an amazing effort to keep us, you know, keep us. Thank you.
I just wanted to also piggyback on some of the comments that were made, and I really enjoyed tonight's presentation. Obviously, I love pouring through the details of the budget too. But you said a couple things that I think bear highlighting newly, which was some of the cost-benefit analysis of cuts. And I think it really is on us. I don't know that we've really explained well, and I will have a hard time explaining it right now, the intersection of sort of cut theater, like things that would really hurt people but wouldn't save money. Like it wouldn't save enough to move the needle, versus the reverse of that, which is the budget fails and it changes the whole scope, you know, twice, and we go to austerity. It changes the whole landscape for decades of what is available to students. So, and I think that some of that is, I haven't jotted it down. I think some of that relates to our size and, you know, the small population of students that we serve, and it relates a little bit to our cost per student, in that we do so much per student because of our size. But, you know, we could cut clubs, but like our whole club investment is like, don't make me quote, I don't remember, but we get a ton of value for our money.
I think it's 600,000.
Yeah, like $500,000, and it services all of our schools. I'm rounding. But I am so conscious of this idea of, it seems like extras, but it's just great value so much of the time. Are you following?
Yeah, okay. Just for a second, I'll say we really learned this when Dr. Smythe and I were going through like the spreadsheet of the numbers of what courses high school students selected in each department, and we realized like it really is there is a lot of need-driven costs, special education, E&L, things like that. That again, I'm not painting any kind of negative light on, but we couldn't find those like 20 teaching positions. Like we really literally could not find them. And we were being very, like, you know, stringent with the sections we were allowing, as you know.
Only other point I kind of wanted to make is that I know that we talk about the potential for this $8 million loss, and we have to go in eyes wide open, and we certainly have to be aware of this potential. But I can tell you, as a board member, as a community member, I don't intend to go down without a fight on that one. Like, I really feel like there is a massive story to be told about, I mean, I could go on and on and on about there are so many elected officials that need to do something wrong for that to happen, for us to be stuck with that $8 million bill in one school year, because the only people that it will hurt are students and taxpayers. So, you know, LIPA owns that land. I won't go on a whole tirade about it, but
I could just mention super quick, not to interrupt you, but this came up in our last community meeting last Wednesday, the 27th, and we got into a really great discussion about, you know, disagreement is healthy, it's democratic, and, you know, but at some point, I'd say in this next year, we have to get, like, two or three talking points that are rallying cries that we totally unify around, regardless of our opinions on budget or other things. And you do, I'll say, Island Park is a good model for that. They're a small community, so it's like a little easier. They're like one of our hamlets, of our five, you know. But they really kind of got that, and I'm looking at them as that's something we can emulate, I think, going into next year. We just got to solidify what those three points are, hit them hard, and communicate, you know, with letter-writing campaigns. Sorry.
Lastly, I had the pleasure of going to all the What Makes Us community meetings, you know, just to listen and learn. And I really appreciated the way that you talked about the themes. And I was really waiting to hear some solutions from community members that we haven't thought of. I was like, what are they going to bring to the table? And people have energy about this. You know, they're concerned, they're plugged in. And it was, you know, it was great. It was a great engagement tool, so I really appreciate you freshly and newly going to the effort of really reaching out in new ways to the community. I could see that it was appreciated, and I certainly appreciated hearing from everyone. So thanks for that opportunity.
Any other questions, comments? Okay, thank you. Everyone should be on the lookout for our next meeting where we adopt the budget on Tuesday, April 16th. Policy review. So this is our first look at a new policy, or an updated policy, 4327,
the homebound instruction policy. Do you want to give a little overview, Chris?
Sure. So this policy relates to instruction that's provided in the home and sometimes remotely for students who are out of school, who are homebound because of illness or for other reasons. And the state had changed the law on this at the end of last school year to increase the hours. Previously, the mandate from New York State was if a student missed 10 consecutive days, the district at the elementary level had to provide 5 hours of instruction a day through home instruction, and secondary level 10 hours, 5 hours a week at the elementary level, 10 hours a week at the secondary level, 1 hour a day, 5 hours, 2 hours a day at the secondary level. That changed. So now it's 10 days in any non-consecutive period, and it's 10 hours at the elementary level and 15 hours at the secondary level. So the hours were increased, and the requirements were dropped in terms of the threshold for triggering homebound instruction. So we took that as an opportunity to look at the whole policy. Some of our protocols needed some work, and so we took a lot of time. We had 4 or 5 meetings on this.
Any questions, comments? It was a very long policy committee met several times on this policy.
I think we rewrote about 70% of it, didn't we?
It wasn't me. It was Carol.
Yes.
Carol. Yeah. Rich?
I just have a quick question. in terms of triggering the mechanism, I know the parent has to make a request for this, but what do we have in place to make people aware of this, clearly aware of it? Because I know, not recently, but from past experience, some people that were eligible weren't aware. So what are we doing to make sure everybody knows?
That is a great question, because I think nurses usually or guidance counselors at the secondary level will reach out, but it hasn't been publicized in the way that you're talking about, which I think is a really good idea. So I think that's something the principals and I would talk about and look at it on the website where we post it, and also talk to our people, our nurses, our assistant principals, our counselors. So especially in the beginning, you know, we make sure they're initiating some of that to make sure they know, making that phone call, that they're eligible. So we did, you know, I think it's a great question. We need to do a little bit more there.
Lisa, I know you submitted some grammatical changes.
Right, I already submitted those to Betty, so all taken care of. But I did have one. This is sort of grammatical, but sort of not. On the 4327EI Form E, the parent letter home instruction plan. So I know, as you just said, it's 2 hours per day at the elementary school and 3 hours at secondary. But this the sentence in the second paragraph, home tutors have approved to provide 2 hours per day at the elementary level, 3 hours of instruction per week at the secondary level. Is that like a, is that something that that is being chosen, or?
Yeah, that should be 3 hours per day, actually. So that is a typo.
Well, right, per day.
Yeah.
But
do you mean like for each subject? How is it determined?
Like, are you saying that you're going to approve, 2 hours per day at the elementary level or 3 hours per week at the, per day at the secondary level?
Those are the standard amounts.
So I guess, are you going to hand this to a parent for an elementary student, and will it say the high school information, or is it more of a drop down? Are you just list?
I think what we were trying to do, and I'll go back and clarify that based on what you're saying. We were trying to make it one form. Yeah, so I think it was 2 forms, and we were trying to make it one form.
I think that's fine. I think I'm being nitpicky. I think maybe then you just need to say or, like, provide 2 hours per day at the elementary level or 3 hours of instruction per day at the secondary level, and then it's probably fine.
Any other comments on this policy? policy.
I thought you guys did a great job.
Oh, man. It was rough.
Impressive catch, though, Lisa.
That was. It'll be back on the agenda sometime soon. All right, I'm going to move to comments from the public. I will now open the podium. If anybody would like to come down, name and town of residence, we welcome you.
Note to self, don't sit so far back. It's a long walk from there. Roger Friedman Seacliff. I didn't see a discussion about the district reserves. Historically, we've had, you know, very healthy reserves, but I know we're using them each year. Is there a projection as to how long those will be there for us to draw from?
Well, we didn't talk about that tonight as much. We talked a little bit last time. We are using more reserves for this budget, $690,000 more than last year. I think as part of our long-term planning here, we need to, and I'd suggest that we wait until after we know what happens with this budget for this year. But they are going down each year, and that is a scary part too. And then, you know, and the state has said this, that that's the answer to the decrease in state aid. But then, of course, when you use these reserves, you create a revenue hole that you're filling with a bucket that's going down itself. So I think we need to perhaps talk about that a little bit more when we know for the next, you know, 3 or 4 years what that's going to look like.
It's another rock and a hard place scenario because you can't replenish reserves in an environment where your costs are going up uncontrollably. Out of your control. Lisa, you took the words right out of my mouth with the $8.5 million cliff. Like, we're not going down without a fight. But who are we fighting? Is this another Blakeman negotiated settlement with LIPA? Is that what it comes down to? I mean,
so that is part of what we're struggling with. We're hearing about, you know, developers going down to the properties on Shore Road, but there are multiple developers. Are they generating power? Are they not? We've been told that, you know, the taxation is based on the generation of power. At what point does transmission become generation? All these questions. So the Nassau County IDA, and I are working with our lobbyists to set up a meeting to get communication to them to get answers. I think that is part of the issue. There is no single entity.
This is America. Isn't there anyone we can sue?
I mean, I think, you know, that this is a good question for our lobbyists. I think, you know, the executive, we've focused a lot on the legislature. I think the executive office, their relationship to LIPA. More importantly, the question is, that is the right question. I think who it is.
Obviously we have Chuck and Delia and Tom and, you know, when do they get brought into this discussion, or can we invite them to a board meeting and a budget presentation? I mean, this is freaking scary. You know, those numbers are terrifying.
That's the attitude, I think, like in your question, and that is the attitude we have to come at it with everybody. And we're being told, like, at the legislative breakfast, it was great, but it was kind of like on us to go to the IDA. You know, it's kind of being put in the bull in our court. So as a community, we need to unify, I think, to strengthen what the local means. It can't just be the school district. It has to be the civics, all of us together, united. And then pinpointing who that is.
My last question is about the, you know, the medical premiums, those are insurance premiums that are dictated by the state, essentially, right? It's a state fund.
We use the New York State Health Insurance Program, which most districts on Long Island do. And then we have a contractual rate, you know, through our contract negotiations for the different units.
They have a share in the cost. They have a percentage cost that they contribute. Each employee contributes.
Average across the units, 20%. And so what that 20% is going up just as, you know, as ours is, our 80% is going up.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, I think 20-25% is pretty standard in, like, in business. I mean, it could be higher, but I don't know about public sector. And is there a, I know in the private sector there's a self-insurance option, you know, where you have a, like a catastrophic policy, where it is, let's say you have a, if your expense goes over, say, $250,000 for any given employee, that would kick in, but you self-insure up into the, up until that amount, and those programs are usually considerably cheaper. You know, and I'm sure somebody actuarially could figure out whether it made sense for us, you know, based on the population and the health or lack thereof of our teachers and staff. But I don't know if that's even an option in public education.
I haven't seen it so much for health insurance. We do have that for our workers' compensation insurance, and we're looking into with an actuary what the different options would be, whether it to stay self-insured, to go to an insured, and see where we land on that. But certainly something to look into.
It could be a good option. And thank you for the great work, and the, you know, thanks to the board, thanks to Mary Ann for all her years of service, and just thanks for everything that you do.
Thank you, Roger. Any other comments? Make sure you speak into the.
Does it? Oh yeah, lights off automatically. Mr. Pappas had mentioned when you were discussing the contingency budget that there's currently a 12% administrative cost. Did you say that? That we currently have a 12% administrative cost, and if we go to a contingency budget, it remains 12%, or it can't go higher than 12%?
The percentage of the administrative costs can't go higher than the percentage, those costs over the program and the administrative costs combined, roughly.
Okay. I just was wondering, because I feel like it was a little bit obscured in the discussion, because we talked about programs, we talked about, you know, teachers and these possibilities, all of the risks of what could get cut. Would director positions be at risk as well? Is that part of the administrative cost?
If the budget went down, you're asking?
What's that?
If we're at a contingency
budget. If it was on a contingency budget,
yes.
Yeah.
We would have to, because of that percentage differential. In our regular budget planning, we haven't done that this year because we eliminated three administrative positions last year. So that was the why behind not putting it into the regular budget planning, but the contingency would require it.
Has it been decided? I don't know if it's, you know, appropriate to be public knowledge yet or not, but has it been decided which teaching positions would get eliminated? You're speaking of nine teaching positions. Is that something that's established or something that we have to wait to find out?
Those were in the slides and they are posted.
Oh, was it? Okay.
Yeah, but really quickly, two of them were contingency positions. One is a humanities position, you know, retirements that we're anticipating. So part of it is a little unclear because we're trying to align it with retirements to maximize the savings.
Okay.
Elementary classroom, anticipated retirement, and an excess section.
I think I heard it, but I just didn't put together what the list was.
Yeah, and I can always share that with you. They are in those slideshows that we've been using, and then the aid positions.
I also, just, you know, to comment and to echo what some people are saying, I really do think that, you know, finding unifying factors and really, you know, getting the community together on certain things and finding out what people are really after, I think is so, so important. So I hope we can continue that work, because I think that's it. I think that's the whole thing, so.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Adeline. Any other public comments? I will now close the floor for public comments.
I'm going to take action 11, Marianne's resignation, with action 12, our personnel from, so it's 12A through K. So you got that, Betty? So it's 11A with 12A through K. Do I have a motion?
Motion.
Okay, I heard a second. Questions, comments? I know we have a retirement. Jersey? Oh, two, that's right.
Two that I know well, two that worked with me for several years at Seacliff. Ms. Moshta Hassani has worked at Seacliff for over 20 years and taught in New York City before as a special educator. Ms. Hassani has done so many different, filled so many different roles at Seacliff School. She's a district resident as well. And she rejuvenated our school garden, you know, after Trustee Mosca really kept it going. She worked in our integrated co-teaching classes in the lower grades. She taught resource rooms. She taught specialized reading. Was just a real advocate for her teachers, her colleagues as well. We are really, really going to miss her. I remember a story with Ms. Hassani where there was a situation with the schedule where teachers couldn't get their classrooms packed up. I forget exactly what was going on, and she organized all the non-classroom teachers to help get it all together. What was funny about this is that teachers in other buildings thought I like mandated the teachers to do Moshta to do that. And it was like they just did it on their own to help their colleagues. Like, that's how amazing these people are. So it was a funny story. And similarly, Ms. Lamberti, who was a second grade teacher for many years and taught reading for the last several years at Seacliff. And even in our conversation when she came into the office to tell me she was retiring, I learned so much. She said, Chris, I wish parents would understand. We were talking about my kids going to college, her daughters who are older, you know, they're out of college. I wish parents would understand that it's not a race, that they're going to end up where they're supposed to go. There was just so much wisdom that I garnered from that conversation. And then just, I said, gosh, this is why I miss being a principal, because you have those conversations every day. Thank goodness for J.B. Carroll. It's just so much wisdom, and that's what these people are. I think what's hard is we're losing people like this to retirement, and it's harder to find those people. They're out there. So thank you, Moshta. Thank you, Maureen.
May I piggyback on that? I didn't have the pleasure of knowing Ms. Lamberti, but I did meet Ms. Hassani very early after my family moved to the district. She was co-teaching in my daughter's kindergarten class. And she just, immediately, I mean, everything about that year was wonderful. Both teachers were incredible. But my daughter had as a six-year-old, had to have a very serious surgery with a very difficult recovery, and it was an orthopedic thing, and she had to wear this horrible thing on her leg, and it was months long. She was on crutches, and Ms. Hassani just took her under her wing. It wasn't, you know, really what was her purview necessarily, but she just made that whole situation livable, and just it just went on from there. I have to mention two other things that, you know, she went so beyond what her role was in terms of supporting the students and their families, and it became so clear to me that she was quite special. And a little tiny thing, one day my daughter was wearing a sweater that was, you know, was one of my favorite sweaters that she had, and a little stain on it that I never could get out. And she, Moshta noticed this and said, you know, I can show you how to get that stain out. And she just, you know, she had my daughter take it off, and she just got the stain out, you know, and it was mostly just elbow grease, and I was just being really dumb about it, but, you know, it was just like, okay, you know, And then I have to reiterate, Dr. Z, what you already mentioned, which was that she so joyfully took over the garden when I needed to step back after, you know, whatever it was, 6 years or 7 years. And we did it together for some time, and then she just, you know, didn't need the help. And it is just thriving and beautiful and incredible under her and her leadership, along with the wonderful people who are helping her now. So it's another area that we will miss her terribly. I will miss her friendship, and I thank her dearly for, excuse me, the privilege of knowing her.
Thank you. I just want to just reiterate that quickly, because I had the pleasure of watching Ms. Sasani work in the garden, and I mean, her love and her dedication was just so apparent. I mean, you know, just loving teaching children and the joy that they got from learning new things in the garden was just a joy for me to watch. And I will say, I also had the pleasure of knowing Miss Lamberti and having, my son had reading services during COVID when it was remote. So as a parent, I got access to something that we never get access to. I got to see what was happening in the classroom because he was just on the computer. And I mean, that was such a difficult time to teach, especially teaching reading to a first or second grader, I can't remember. But I mean, she was so good at it. Just again, the dedication was just wonderful, and she was so successful and just went above and beyond. So I'm sorry to see both of them go, but I wish them good luck.
All right, all in favor? Okay, thank you. I'm gonna move on, I'm trying to move a little quickly here. I'm gonna combine action 13, acceptance of donations, with 14, our approval of NYSLAT Academy instructors. Did I say that right?
NYSLAT. Yeah.
Okay. And action 15, approval of change orders A and B. So this is 13 A and B, 14, and 15 A and B. Do I have a motion?
Motion.
Okay, I heard a second. Questions, comments? Thank you to CASA, who donated $700 to the high school for the teen intervention program. And thank you to North Shore Lacrosse Club, who helped offset one of the high school girls' lacrosse team's trip by donating $2,500. Okay, all in favor? Thank you. All right, so now we're going to move to action 16, approval of contracts. Action 17. I caught what you had, Maria.
Sorry.
Approval of health services contracts A and B. Action 18, approval of the intermunicipal cooperative transportation agreement. And guess what? I'm going wild tonight. Action 19, the IEPs. Okay? So I have a motion.
Motion.
Okay. Questions, comments?
I have a question / comment, excuse me, on action 16. I will try not to cough through it. I just wanted to thank you, Mr. Pappas, and point out this is in response to the question has come up many times about our various insurance expenses, and Roger Friedman alluded to it too in the workman's comp. So here we the actuarial study that we are approving tonight is actually to look at the Nassau County Workers' Compensation Consortium and to provide an annual cost of membership, which then has to be approved by the existing members of the consortium, right?
Correct.
And you mentioned that you are also at the same time looking at the Workers' Compensation Alliance, and that you will, I know, you know, be coming back with more information when you have gathered it, and we will vote on whether to proceed trying to get into one or the other of those. I was just wondering, you go on in the backup that you gave us in your update to talk about the excess workers' comp coverage, again, that we just heard from Roger. In either case, of these two possible consortia, am I correct that we would be able, if we joined those were accepted for membership, we would be able to drop our coverage then for excess workers' comp?
It would, yes. one thing to recognize is that going into a new program, whether it be the cooperative or being fully insured with the alliance, that would cover us beginning from the point where we joined those two. For instance, July 1st going forward, but we still have to cover claims that might have occurred or could be existing prior to that. So we would still be self-insured for those older claims, and we would probably still have a small portion of that insurance, but overall we're looking to save money.
Right, okay. And so just to clarify, that's a really interesting point, right? Pre-existing claims, or is it possible that claims could still arise, but they would be for the period of time before we joined the consortium?
I think we would be safe from that not happening, okay. Yes. So okay. It would be just covering those going back. And the majority of that are insurance we would be able to eliminate. We still have our reserve to cover the costs of older claims.
Okay, and over time, fully eliminate once
correct.
All those claims were settled.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? All in favor? All right, excellent. We're now going to move to the board committee reports. We've been talking about this the last couple of meetings. Our goal is to keep them quick. It doesn't need to be a script of everything that happened, just an overview, right? Who wants to go first?
Lisa should go, definitely.
Oh, wait, I see Rich. Rich, let Rich go.
This will be very brief.
Good, good. Follow his lead, folks.
So we had a safety committee meeting, I think it was March 17th, I don't know the date. And things are pretty much status quo. We're in good shape in terms of drills. We're in good shape in terms of training. We still look at offering programs that are useful to faculty and staff that will be helpful to the students and to the people that work here. So those are things that we're still looking at. But the biggest piece is the draft of the district-wide safety plan that was presented to us. Our goal for the month was to review it, go through it, and make any changes we thought would be appropriate, and we will be meeting next Wednesday to discuss them. I think my date's straight. Not next Wednesday, 2 weeks from Wednesday, from week after, to go through that. And the reality of the situation, as I had said the last time, was there really are very minimal changes involved. The program's, you know, in good shape. There are very few things that state's mandating to make changes are. So overall, everything looks great. Thank you.
Athletic advisory?
I'm going to be so quick. You're not.
I love it.
We met on February 26th. We talked about a lot of things that we've already covered since the meeting was February 26th. So I will just say one of the things that hasn't been covered here, which I'm talking about, like all the championships and the wins and all of that, and sports night, is we were talking about facilities for a good portion of the meeting and just our needs and our wish list, things like the track and the press box, those kinds of things. So people, you know, just were throwing out ideas. And the other thing we talked about was just the sportsmanship spectator policies and expectations and coach communications on this, clarity of messaging, streamlining where the messaging is.
Excellent.
One thing, we're going to do a walkthrough of athletic facilities. This was just yesterday. So
it's not in my notes, but it's good.
I sent the email, so I should know. on Tuesday, the weather's going to be nice. It might actually hit 70. So we're going to do that at 1 o'clock, and we're going to start the softball field right outside Don's office, and then probably focus on the middle school and the high school.
Great, Mac.
Okay. The big highlight is that some members of LAC were able to participate in the excellent meeting that Dr. Z set up with the Propel group to discuss transmission lines being proposed from our substation in Glenwood Landing to cross the Sound, to cross the harbor. It's a pretty ambitious project that we heard about in some detail for the first time, although mostly an overview that made very clear, I think a lot of great, Trustee Cashman was on the call, as Trustee Ludmore and I were, and a lot of great questions were asked. I think one of the takeaways in terms of LAC activities already alluded to is that we're ramping up our attempts to meet with organizations that can give us more answers, the IDA being one. But I think from that meeting, it sounds to me like we also need to really push trying to get to the PSC. I know we haven't debriefed, but LAC is actually meeting next week, so it always seems like I'm giving the LAC report on the eve of the next LAC meeting when we expect to get a lot of stuff done. So anyway, that's the highlight right now.
Construction steering.
I was trying to tell Jamie that I brought the wrong notebook, so hopefully he can help me hop along with construction steering. But basically, everything's moving forward with the libraries. We're on track with, it's unclear, you probably can give a more timely update about where we stand with the libraries, which I think a lot of people are interested in, if you don't mind.
Yes, they have begun work again on the libraries. They are moving forward. The thing that's holding things up is carpentry and millwork, putting in the shelves, but they are progressing with that too. They're working every day. They've also done a number of the bathrooms in each of the elementary schools, so that work that was originally supposed to happen quite a while ago is moving forward. And if you want.
Sorry, not to interrupt, but I did want to mention the high school front entrance. There is a chance we can open part of the high school front entrance, the security vestibule. When we met at construction steering, we talked about how there's part of the walkway is unfinished, the benches. Now we can isolate that part and have a clear path like we did for the musical if you came in that way, and the security vestibule will open. So we met with Savin and we met with John Hall, and that would allow us to open up the security vestibule sooner, which I think we should do as soon as possible. So we'll talk about it in construction steering, but if we could get the security guard and have kids coming in through the secure vestibule, I think that's the safest thing to do as soon as we can.
I know we have wellness. Any other committees? So I did, we both did wellness, but I think you missed one, right?
Well, I mean, we never talked about the February 12th meeting. I'll just say very quickly, February.
I have it here if you want. Yeah.
It's because you guys voted to postpone board committee reports. our foci on 212 was review of the pulse data and physical wellness.
And
focus.
Yeah. So we just talked about the both faculty and staff pulse survey, and we reviewed that. We had a robust discussion about that, and we talked about physical wellness in all of our schools and the Bach Harrison survey, which was coming up and now is done.
Yeah, and I will say the results of the pulse survey with the employees is that we have a very healthy organization. I mean, so that was great. We on 318, Alan Levin spoke about a new oven that's installed in the high school, which he called, quote, out of this world. Where we're steaming more vegetables, grilling hamburgers, butter chicken, and carne asada.
Is that the one he got through the grant?
Yes, right? Oh. Right, yes. And that there are four more ovens are going to be installed in the other schools that are like high-speed ovens that are like what you see at Starbucks when you're making a breakfast sandwich. So that, right? I think I got that right. We talked about the outdoor wellness center. CASA wants to, so generous, wants to make some more donations to the middle school wellness center. We talked about how that could affect the outdoor areas. And then Kelly Huggins talked about a stress management kind of breakfast club that she runs. It's a social circle meditation group. And we talked a little bit more about the pulse survey and maybe looking, I know you guys ran a program for the employees that was wellness oriented, and it was well received by the faculty. And there you go. Any unfinished business? Any new business? Okay. I will now adjourn the meeting. I will see you all
in less than 2 weeks. Thank you to everyone.